Check, check. All right, so you're on the right one, the one that says bald-headed pastor who's scared of the rapture. All right. This is Joey, the bald-headed pastor who is scared of the rapture.
Scared of the rapture, really? This is Jared, the pastor's brother. Joey, are you serious? What are you scared of?
Well, even if you have to ask, dude. All right, I'll get to that in a second. This is the Pastor with No Answers podcast. So, Jared, do you know how we were brought up at church? Like, we were brought up to be scared to death of the rapture. Jared? Jared? Jared! Oh, gosh. I gotta call Priscilla. She's in good spiritual shape. She'd be gone too if the rapture came. Oh crap! It went straight to voicemail. Let me call Toby. That's not helpful. I'm gonna call my parents. They'd be gone too for sure. Voicemail.
Dude, what's wrong?
Oh my gosh, you're back. Where were you, man? I thought the rapture had happened.
No, man. Gosh, I had to go to the bathroom.
What were you doing?
I had to go to the bathroom.
Oh my gosh, dude. Oh my gosh. Dude, do you remember those moments? Like, for real?
Yeah. For real. That's some serious panic.
I'm serious, dude. Did you ever have those situations? Like, where you walked in the house and mom was supposed to be there? And she wasn't there, and maybe she was, like, in the backyard for some weird reason, but you start walking around the house saying, Mom?
Yes.
Mom?
I think I even, at some point, like, when there was no one in the house, I would call a relative that I knew was a Christian, and when they picked up, I would just hang up the phone just to make sure.
Yeah, Mama was, I think Mama was my go-to.
Yeah, definitely.
Like, if she answered fine, I'd be like, oh,
yep.
I'm okay.
Yeah. This is scary stuff, like, though.
Yeah, I mean... But here's the weird thing about how we were brought up with in Pentecostal churches about the rapture and all that stuff. So I used to think, I was like, well, you know what? If I miss the rapture, that's really, really going to suck. But at that point, I know I'm not going to miss heaven because all I have to do is not get the mark of the beast. Basically, right. If you're left behind, it's black and white. Don't get the mark of the beast and you're okay.
Yeah. That's true.
I mean, so you may get tortured, but at least you know you're not going to be in eternal torment. So, I think you're a little more studied on this sort of thing than me. Have you heard the rapture is supposed to happen. A lot of people believe this way. So the church is going to be raptured, taken before tribulation. Have you heard some people talk about, so in the New Age movement, people are so there's Christians basically saying in the New Age movement there's demons already speaking to people in the New Age, explaining away the rapture by basically saying the spiritual forces are talking to people saying that there will be a time when Mother Nature will have to cleanse herself from, you know, with millions and millions and millions of people being wiped off the face of the earth in an instant.
Well,
and so basically demonic forces explaining away the rapture already.
Well, no, I've heard it a little bit differently. I've heard the message being that there are these backwards Christians who are basically keeping us from reaching our evolutionary potential.
Right.
And so to cleanse the earth of these backwards, closed-minded people, once they're gone, then we can reach our true potential as the human race and evolve further to a higher state. So yeah, I definitely have heard that. That is a message that, you know, alien contactees have heard. So.
Whoa, did you just say alien contactees?
Yes.
That's pretty crazy.
What do you think New Age is?
Yeah.
It's contact with spirits, and so I believe they're one and the same. So yes.
We are here today with two old friends as in recent guests. So Chip and Ryan, you guys passed Good job.
Y'all. Barely.
Which one's barely, Jared?
Ryan. Hothead.
Jared, lick my... Never mind.
And,
did you say pothead?
What did you say? What?
Yeah. Did you say pothead?
No.
I did say pothead.
Chip. Yeah, so okay. So we had a recent episode, Chip, on Christians and marijuana, and Ryan was our former pothead. So he spent a good bit of his Christian walk also being a pothead. But you've laid off the weed, right?
Yeah, for the most part.
All right, so if you guys want to hear more about Ryan choosing weed over Jesus once in a while, you can go to one of our previous episodes. But, Chip, good to have you back on. Lots of people enjoyed hearing some things that Chip has said in the past. And so, yeah, I'm looking forward to this conversation. Neat little dynamics. Two people that I think very highly of and love a lot as well. And the question at hand is a very simple question, and that is God in control? So just to clarify, when we're talking about God, the four of us are Christians, so we're talking specifically the God of the Bible, and Jesus would fall in that as well. I mean, you know, the whole Trinity thing. But before we do that, I want to do a little warm-up exercise, ask a very simple question, and none of you guys were prepared for this question, but I want y'all to it's going to be the honor system, so you need to form a number in your head or write it down, and I don't want you to change it no matter what. If someone influences your answer, I still want to hear what you wrote down originally. So the question is, what percent of God, or what there is to know about God, is revealed in God's Word? So when it comes to everything there is to know about God, what percentage, or percent, however I'm supposed to say it, I don't know, what percentage of that knowledge is revealed in God's Word? So is there anybody unclear on the question?
No, I'm good.
All right, Ryan, you wrote a number down. What is that?
10%.
10%. All right, so Ryan is basically saying of everything there is to know about God, 10% of it is revealed in His Word. What about you, Jared?
Zero.
So
well, God is infinite, so you can't have a percent of an infinite.
Wow. Oh,
mathematician.
So basically, you don't believe in God's Word. It hasn't...
No, I do, but when you have an infinite being... what's the percent of an infinite?
All right, now philosophically, though, aren't you saying that there's nothing that you can learn about God through His Word?
Your question is bullshit.
Okay. Chip, let's hear from you.
All right, I'm going to change the question with one phrase. What percentage of God that I need to know about Him is revealed in His Word? And I'd say 100%.
All right, but what I agree with you. What would you say, though, is revealed?
I'm going to say 100%.
So everything there is to know about God is revealed in the Bible. Explain that.
I believe just like a poet can pack 3,000 words into one word, I believe God can pack everything we need to know about Him into His gift of revelation to us about Himself.
Now, okay,
but not if we look at it like a normal book. I mean, I believe just like there's a gazillion amount of energy packed into one atom, I believe there can be a gazillion amount of information packed into one word.
All right, so you're not saying when we get to heaven, we're going to look at God or look at Jesus and say, there's nothing else that I need to know about You. I know everything. You're saying that possibility is there, we just don't attain it on this earth?
Yeah, I think everything we need to know about God in His Word, but I don't think we'll ever get to the bottom of it.
Gotcha. Okay.
In one lifetime.
Right. Jared, Ryan?
No, I mean, I agree with the fact that everything we need to know about God is there. I would agree with that statement.
Okay. All right, three more questions, and everybody's going to have exactly 30 seconds to answer. You do not get any time to prepare if you're the first person. 30 seconds, and at 30 seconds, we buzz you off. You have to stop. The first question is, when you are married, is there any type of opposite sex close friendship that you can have outside of your marriage? So basically, if you're a husband, can you have a tight relationship with a girl, not your sister, not your mom, that's not your wife, and it be okay? Jared?
Yes.
Yes. You want to explain what that looks like?
Well, I mean, I guess, what do you mean by tight?
Well, I just mean, so...
You don't mean physically tight, do you?
No. So one of your closest friends is a girl, and your wife doesn't know her.
Well, that's a little bit different.
That's what I mean.
The wife doesn't even know her at all?
Yeah. She's not a part of the friendship. So she doesn't have a relationship with her.
Then I would probably say no then.
You would say no.
I guess I was assuming that you meant that maybe a friend that you carried over from your old life into your married life, that she kind of carried over with you. I think yes to that.
Yeah, I'm saying it's someone you have a close relationship that Sarah does not have a relationship with. So it's harmless, it's innocent, but you're talking to her on the phone once in a while. You know, she's telling you struggles and that sort of thing. And yeah, Sarah's cool with it, but Sarah doesn't know this girl.
I think that's going to be a per individual type question.
Per individual. Okay. What about you, Ryan?
I just think if you're married, why wouldn't she know her? That'd be really weird. If I had a guy friend, I think that'd be weird if my wife didn't know her. So, no, I think if you got some secret girlfriend, I mean, some secret friend who's a girl, no, that sounds like a Drake song, not a Christian relationship.
All right. So Michelle knows that you have this friendship. She just doesn't know her.
But either way, that's weird. I mean, either way, like, I wouldn't have a guy friend and that I was close to that Michelle didn't know. No, that's strange.
Okay. I'm going to say I do think this – I'm pretty old school and black and white on this issue. I don't think there's ever a good reason for a wife or a husband to have a close relationship with someone of the opposite sex that's outside of their marriage that their spouse doesn't know. I just think that you're opening the door for, some – potentially bad stuff. But I want to hear what Chip has to say, because Chip, you've seen hundreds of failed marriages, hundreds of marital affairs. Where do you land on this?
I mean, my deal is I don't want to have any female friends that are not friends with my wife. I would say there's two ways good people get in trouble, and one is what I would call emotional adultery.
Yep.
Meaning having an emotional connection with someone of the opposite sex that goes beyond lines where your spouse would be comfortable. And men don't differentiate between, emotional connection and sexuality very well. Everything's kind of sexual to a guy. So it's just a recipe for disaster. Most good people don't plan on getting in trouble. They just wake up there and wonder how they got there.
Gotcha. All right, we're going to just do one more question instead of three, and this one's a little more philosophical. Did God create morality? So the system of morality, I think we all agree that it's pretty much fixed. We may not know exactly what that morality is. There may be some things we're still searching and trying to figure out, but whatever that system is, did God create it? Ryan.
No, God didn't create it. I think he just had to explain it to us because we clearly wouldn't get it on our own. So, no, I think morality is just describing to someone who's colorblind what a color looks like. You know what I mean? He's just describing goodness to us in terms that we can understand. And in doing so, he has to describe to us, mainly focusing on everything we can't do.
All right. Jared?
Yeah, I think morality reflects God's nature. So, yeah, I think he created it. Well, I think it's existed with God.
So he didn't create it, though.
it reflects. Yeah, I guess not. I guess it just reflects his perfect being.
Right. How about you, Chip?
I'm not sure about the use of the word created, but I would say just like there's laws of physics and electricity and gravity and everything else built into God's creation, I assume the rules of engagement between human beings is written into creation. So I guess I would say he created it.
Okay, that's interesting.
He scripted it.
Right. Now, so what if he scripted for murder to be okay?
Then we'd be okay with it.
Uh-huh. That's interesting. I got in a big argument with a couple of guys because I think that morality, I would agree with how Ryan described it. It's kind of like a natural reflection of who God has always been throughout eternity. But yeah, that's interesting how you explain that. All right, and last question, Chip, Ryan, myself, and Jared, we all want to know, how's the Carolina Gamecocks doing this year?
Joe, I just lost the connection. I can't hear you. It sounded like you said something about, I don't know, I'm not sure. You changed subjects, though, from spiritual to something else.
All right, so is God in control? Let me form a little bit of structure to this conversation, and then we'll hear what Ryan, Chip, and Jared's initial reaction to that simple question is. Obviously, everyone has heard the philosophical back and forth as far as, okay, is God perfectly good, and is he perfectly powerful? If he's perfectly good and perfectly powerful, there's bad things that happen. All right, so the next step would be people would say, okay, well, wait a second. If bad things happen, then God cannot be both perfectly good and perfectly powerful. But I think that, and you can correct me in your opening statement, I think the four of us would say, as we describe God, yeah, he's all-powerful, and he's perfectly good, and yet bad things do happen. All right, so those are just some things to reflect on. So goes back to our original question, is God in control? And we'll let Chip open it up.
I think it's important to even put a frame around the question, like, why bother? Why are we even talking about this? And I think it has, you know, powerful implications for people that are looking at faith, questioning faith, thinking about it. Because when we say, when we drop some of the one-liners we drop, you know, you're at a funeral for a two-year-old child and you glibly say, not glibly, but you just need reflex say, well, God's in control. I just think we set thought processes in motion that are just weird.
Yeah.
But let me say this. I think we need to make a distinction verbally between is God in control versus is God in charge. Like, I believe God is in charge, meaning he's totally, completely sovereign. But in his sovereignty, he's not micromanaging everyone's life. So sometimes that changes the dialogue, because some people are like, oh, okay, well, as long as you're saying I've never questioned God's sovereignty, but I don't believe his sovereignty is worked out through in blanket statements like God's in control. Like, I would say this, does God always get what he wants? My Lord, he doesn't in my life. I don't know if he does in yours.
Yeah.
But, so, okay, then time out. If God doesn't always get what he wants, how can he be in control? Do my choices have consequences? I think we all agree that they do. Well, I can make some pretty crappy choices.
Yeah.
And I don't necessarily think that produced a consequence that God wanted. Can God weave that into something good? I believe he can.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean he's in control. That just means he's really, really smart, and he can take any mess I make and turn it into something halfway decent. But that doesn't mean it's what he wanted in the first place.
Gotcha. All right, low-hanging fruit is the woman that's in the hospital after brutally being raped. God did not get his way there.
I sure don't think he did.
Right. Now, I don't want to misquote anyone. I haven't listened to him enough, but am I correct that there's definitely some very revered theologians such as John Piper? I'm pretty sure he would say to that girl, look, I know that this is hard to understand, but hopefully this brings peace that this was a part of God's plan. Like, God is in control, and this was supposed to happen. I want to say I'm not positive, but I think that's how he would treat that issue.
No, I totally heard that from him.
Yeah, yeah, so you have heard that from John Piper?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and I would definitely feel free and comfortable to go on the record and say that kind of points a pretty sick picture of God. Now, do I think John Piper's a messed up guy? No. I mean, I think that he's on the same quest we are, you know, studying a very tough thing to grasp, and that's just how God operates. But I agree with Chip that definitely puts some whacked out thoughts in people's minds. So, Chip, you're basically saying that sovereignty and control are two very distinct things.
Right. Okay. Right. And again, I can't remember if you mentioned this, but I've been a marriage and family counselor for over 30 years.
Yeah.
And when you sit and listen to the stories I've listened to, I mean, if God's in control, he needs to find a good counselor.
Yeah.
Because he's got issues.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, Jared, how do you respond to that?
Go
ahead, Chip.
I was going to say, if God is in control and he's managing reality, I'm not sure I want to go to heaven.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, Jared.
Yeah, I guess it's semantics because, I mean, I kind of see sovereignty and control as the same thing. Now, do I think that God is in control of everything? No, I think God can relinquish his control, but I think at any moment in time, he can step in and exercise control. So I guess I kind of see sovereignty being the ability to take control or to relinquish control.
Yeah.
So I think God can and does do both. He can exercise whenever he wants to, or he can relinquish control whenever he wants to, and his sovereignty.
All right, so you're saying
that's where I stand.
So you're saying that God can have complete control.
Yes.
But you would say he forfeits that.
Yes.
Okay. So the woman that was raped, you're visiting her in the hospital, you wouldn't tell her that, hey, God is in complete control. I know it's hard to understand, but this was God's will.
I would not say that. I would say that God is aware of your situation, God loves you, and God can work despite this terrible situation. That would be my words of comfort is God is aware of the situation. He loves you. He died for you. He can work this to good, you know, through your faith and through his Holy Spirit. So that's how I would approach it. But I would not say that God scripted this or God, this is part of God's master plan in your life. No, I don't think I'd say that.
Yeah. All right. What about you, Ryan?
If I'm trying to sell the theory of God in the 21st century, no, of course I wouldn't say that. But if I'm reading scripture and having to face some really strong language, I can't come up away with anything other than the fact that God's in complete control. Because even if he's relinquishing control, it's still happening on his watch. If you're sovereign, if you're a manager of a particular shift, just because you didn't steal the goods doesn't mean that you weren't turning a blind eye or weren't handling your stuff when things were walking out the back door. So my point is that I don't think you can talk a big game like God does and then go, well, but, you know, not everything. You know, all the good stuff I'll take credit for, but all the bad stuff, clearly that wasn't my intention. I think that's too convenient, and I also think there's plenty of scripture that speaks directly to that matter of, hey, God does the good, but guess what? God's also in charge of the bad.
So how do you talk to the girl in the hospital? this metaphorical girl.
Shame on you for sending me to the hospital to console her.
yeah, on your watch too, Joey.
the thing is that you can't speak to her in any terms that'll console her. I mean, that's like trying to console Job in his. You know what I mean? His friends came and tried to earnestly console him with their words, and there was no console to be had because at the end of the day, God looks at him and says, you know, who's the pot to talk to the potter like that? So I think it's at the end of the day, you have to chalk it up to God's ways are higher than our ways, and that's where the trust factor comes in.
All right, Chip, what do you say to that young lady?
I say to her that we live in a world that's fallen desperately away from God's loving care, and that she has been caught in the crossfire of good and evil, and God is well able to comfort her, heal her, and help her have a wonderful life, but she's going to need help walking through this.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't. A few minutes ago, the thought was said that God can relinquish control and he can take it back. I would go so far as to say this. God not only can relinquish control, he did relinquish control in the first chapter of the book when he said, let's create man in our image, let's give them dominion. And then there's two words that I think the church, the body of believers scattered throughout the earth, haven't properly processed yet. And that is the two words, let them have dominion. I would insert a different word. It's in Genesis 1, 26 through 28, where God said about freshly created humanity, let them have responsibility for the earth. And I believe God initiated a situation back in Genesis chapter 1, where he basically said, I am sovereign over everything that is, but I'm giving you co-sovereignty over this particular planet. And you can do with it as you will, but there will be consequences. And in very short order, we broke our engagement with him and brought havoc into the earth. So God is still in the same position he was then, and that is, I'll help anywhere you invite me.
Yeah.
But so I believe God did relinquish control. I believe the reason the earth's in the mess it's in is because we're running it.
Yeah, so my question is to Ryan. So Ryan, in your perspective of God's sovereignty and God's control, where does free will fit in?
Free will's not mutually exclusive to what I'm thinking here, because I do agree wholeheartedly with you guys that God does relinquish his will, his direct control over things. But I guess the implication for the young lady who's in the hospital, that doesn't make her feel better, because at the end of the day, God's still in control. It's still on his watch, so to speak. That's all, yeah. I was pointing out there is that I feel like we're trying to let God off the hook, I guess. And if you're going to be in control, you're in control. And I guess I would say that God's not scared of God's not scared of overseeing some dirty stuff, I guess.
So maybe it's just that when God is in control, he's either exercising that control or he just has that control. Maybe, because I think that God always has that control, but whether he directly exercises that control and intervenes in the matters of man, that happens sometimes, sometimes it doesn't. But I think God always has the ability, he always possesses that control. So I guess you could say it's on his watch. I mean, if you want to say that, yeah, sure, it's on God's watch. But I think because God gave us free will, you know, God acknowledges, like I think what Chip's suggesting, is that we do have some dominion on this earth.
Oh, certainly. Yeah. I'm not arguing that. I mean, I guess it depends on if we're talking big picture or micromanaging. But it does seem like God exercises some very precise control, micromanages certain situations. And then we all seem to accept the idea that we are left to our own devices in certain situations. But that at the end of the day, that we can't thwart God's ultimate plans. And so you're kind of going, I find myself in this kind of conversation waffling back in between. We all can agree that God's ultimate plan is going to be exercised, right? And we all agree,
yes,
that God doesn't micromanage every second of every life on this earth.
But he could.
So where do we fall on that in between?
That's God's mind. We're not privy to that.
Yeah.
All right, so Chip, when you say that... If God is in complete control, he needs counseling. What would you say to someone that says, well, the fact that God gives us so much responsibility, he needs counseling?
I mean, there's no two ways about it. If you're a thinking person, you have to, I don't think God's afraid to say I'm responsible for all of it. I mean, because if I strike a match that starts a little fire in my backyard that eventually burns a city down, I burn the city down. Intentionally, no. Did I control it? You know, whatever, no. But I created the forces, the context, the situation and circumstances within which it could happen, and then I struck the first match. So God, in his sovereignty, wisdom, and delight, created a system within which people were going to be hurt.
Yeah.
I have to believe, and I'm not going to say that there aren't times where I say, God, if one person goes to hell, why did you do this?
Yeah.
But I know him. I've touched his heart. I've tasted his love. I know his reasons are going to be good. But there's some things I don't have answers to. But I believe I believe God knew Genesis 3 was going to happen, that the human race is going to fall away from him. But I don't necessarily believe he caused it, allowed it, controlled it. I believe there's nothing that catches them off guard. But foreknowledge is not the same thing as causation. Knowing something's going to happen doesn't mean I caused it to happen.
Yeah.
And I don't think anything's outside of his awareness. But I think I love this. I call it the Trinity of Triumph. These three words that run together, and I believe they always run in a certain order. And the three words are responsibility, authority, and power. And I think we want to throw around authority and power, but we don't want to deal with responsibility.
Yeah.
And here's a simple train of logic. I'd be happy for you guys to answer. Does the church, big C, the church as a whole, pray like it ought to pray? What do y'all think? Yes or no?
Yeah, of course not.
No.
No.
But now listen to our answers. Of course not. No. All right. Does the church pray like it ought to pray? No. Do you believe prayer makes a difference?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. All right. Does the church pray like it ought to pray? No. Does prayer make a difference? Yes. And then we're going to say, after all of that, that God's still in control. That what God wants to happen happens. So it doesn't. Apparently, it doesn't matter if we do what we should do. It doesn't matter if we're obedient. It doesn't matter if we adhere to the principles and rules of engagement of creation.
Yeah.
God's going to somehow magically make the right thing happen.
Yeah, and I would say that all of this stuff really does confuse me. Hearing some of the stuff, what you've said in years past of knowing you, has definitely enlightened me, but I still am confused. But I would say Ryan would be pretty hard pressed to make a point based on what you said, as far as, and I'm not selling Ryan out. I'm often in his shoes too, but I'm basically, Ryan is saying, yeah, God is in control and prayer makes a difference. I don't think you can say both of those. What would you see what I'm saying?
So yeah. Except we're, so we have already established that God relinquishes control, and I think that is the game that he has rigged, and it's a situation where he purposefully relinquishes certain control, and he purposefully sets up a situation where we have some sort of causality. Is that a word?
Yes, sure.
We're going to make it a word for this discussion, causality.
Come on, man.
People can cause things, where we have a cause and effect relationship with the matter of this earth. So I do think that God has set it up like that. And I guess what we're arguing here is, where is God's power and where is God's responsibility? And I think we're all fairly much on the same page as far as his power goes. He could micromanage absolutely everything if he wanted to. I think we're all on the same page there. But it seems to me like some of the other opposing arguments want to let God off the hook as far as responsibility for bad things.
All right. Now, let's not totally changing gears, but let's throw some curveballs, or at least I think they're curveballs. I'm going to read two verses, and Ryan just said that our perspective is kind of letting God off the hook as far as putting a lot of the responsibility on us. And I think Ryan used the word, he's still overseeing the world is still on his watch. Let me read two scriptures. One is both of them are from 1 Samuel. I don't know if there's a lot of examples outside of that. I would say that the thorn that Paul had, it says a messenger was sent to torment him. I think God sent it, but I'd have to double check that. But 1 Samuel 16:14 says, "Now the spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him." 1 Samuel 19:9 says, "But an evil spirit from the Lord came on Saul as he was sitting in his house with his spear in his hand while David was playing the lyre." So those are just two passages where it looks like God's sovereign over evil spirits, and he uses them to mess with people.
Do you mind if I jump in and throw a heaping shovel full on top of that?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right.
Bring it on, man.
These are kind of my God can be evil when he wants to be verses.
Did you just say God can be evil?
Sure. So obviously the entire book of Job leaves that up to question. The fact that God allowed Job to be turned over to Satan. Proverbs 16:14, "The Lord has made everything for its purpose, even the wicked for the day of trouble." Isaiah 45:7, "I form the light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does these things." Deuteronomy 32:39, "See now that I, even I, am he, and there is no God beside me. I kill and I make alive. I wound and I heal. There's no one that can be delivered out of my hands." Ecclesiastes 7:13. You know what, I'm going to skip that one because Ecclesiastes gets kind of tongue-in-cheek at times. Job 12, "He makes nations and he destroys them. He enlarges nations and leads them away." 1 Samuel 2, "The Lord kills and brings life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up." Lamentations, "Is it not from the mouth of the Most High that good and bad come?"
So I guess the question we're faced with is, if we would have prayed to God, "Hey, please don't send an evil spirit," would that have changed his mind? And then we have to question, okay, well, what kind of loving father, if we're taking this at face value, what kind of loving father would say, "Hey, you didn't ask me not to send an evil spirit, so I sent an evil spirit"? I mean, I would never tell my son, "Hey, you didn't ask me not to give you poison, so I gave you poison, man. You should have asked me not to." And I love God. I think God is perfectly good. So I'm definitely not, obviously, I don't even have to say this to you guys, but for our listeners, I'm definitely not arguing against the goodness of God. I'm just saying this is some confusing stuff, man.
You know, when you hear the word calamity and that God causes calamity, do you think that the flood in Genesis, is that an evil act on God's part?
I don't think God does evil.
A lot of people would argue that.
I think that God orchestrated that. I think God caused that, and it did cause calamity. So I think you have to be careful about associating calamity necessarily with evil and bad things. I think God accomplished good things through that flood.
All right, let me throw something at you. So I guess if you boil it down, the point that I'm trying to make is that good and evil and God's sovereignty, we're trying to talk about it in human terms, whereas these terms may not necessarily apply to God. For instance, back to Joey's original question of, did God establish morality, right? He established he actually did, I believe, establish a certain set of rules for us that he probably had to establish because it was us that was, they were concerning. So for instance, is it, nobody here throws the book at God for allowing or creating death and allowing that to enter into this earth and for people dying. Yet we all consider death to be a bad, evil thing, right? So the point is that because when the rules apply to us, yes, you can generously use terms like evil and bad and calamity and that kind of thing. When they are applied to God, it's sort of, you kind of have to go to an all bets are off sort of thing. It explicitly in Scripture comes back to that idea of, who are you to tell me how to do my job? Who is the clay to tell the potter what he should form? You see what I'm saying?
I can buy into that, because I mean, ultimately, I think it depends on God's perspective, and we don't have that perspective.
Exactly.
So even though these acts may appear evil in God's grand scheme of things, they could be accomplishing something far more good and perfect than we could ever imagine.
Exactly.
So I'll buy into that argument.
So for that reason, I can't help but think that we're perpetuating deceit when we tell the mother in the hospital, this was not God's plan, this was not God's responsibility, this was, you know, when we make excuses for God.
Well, what Ryan, with your argument then, you got to take it to day one and say, God caused Adam and Eve, and he caused all this mess. So, I mean, you're straight up 100% Calvinist.
I'm not saying that. I'm not saying I would go that far, but I wouldn't put it past him. I wouldn't say I could never serve a God like that. I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, Chip. But basically, the idea that you proposed at the beginning of if that's a good God, then I don't want nothing to do with it. That's I would not nearly go that far, because I do think all bets are off when you come to God. For instance, if you take the story out of Exodus of the Pharaoh, it clearly says several times that God hardened Pharaoh's heart, right? And then later on, oh man, I don't have the scripture in front of me, but it says, I'll find it in a minute. It says he tells Moses to go to, or Moses or Aaron, whichever, to go to Pharaoh and explain to him that I raised you up into this power position of into this position that you're in of power, simply so I could bring these plagues on you and display my power, so that Israel's sons and grandsons would all know the glory of God. He raised up an evil guy to lord over the Israelites so long and so harshly that they had to beg to come back to God, and he had to send plagues, and God takes full credit for that.
Yeah, but what if Pharaoh, what if God is saying, because I've read that verse many times, to say God was going to raise this guy up no matter what. So if this guy was evil, then it ended up being an evil person that he raised up. If this guy had a heart yielded to God, and I think, I want to say that Pharaoh's heart was hardened first before God started saying, okay, I'm just going to keep hardening that sucker. So in other words, if God knows that someone's heart is never going to be yielded to him, then I would say at that point, God can and should use that person in any way he sees fit to bring more glory to himself, which will extend his kingdom. But yeah, I mean, everything you're saying is stuff that I've thought through. Before we change gears, Chip, do you have anything to say about all this evil spirit stuff? And
well, I mean, a couple of thoughts. Like the word, a minute ago about the young lady in the emergency room and saying that God didn't cause it. I would use that kind of wording, but I wouldn't say God's not responsible. Because ultimately, if God's the creator of all that is, then he created the context in which that could happen, so he bears some responsibility.
Yeah.
But that's a big difference. The whole issue of did God cause Adam and Eve to fall? I don't believe God caused Adam and Eve to fall, but my Bible says Jesus was crucified before the foundations of the world. In other words, God knew it was going to happen, and he still started everything. So I get when we're trying to think through, well, you know, did he know what was going to happen? Did he cause it? Whatever. And again, my point is, I believe, goodness, there's so many different directions to go. I believe for God to create an environment where he can have a love relationship with his creatures, they had to have the freedom to choose. And the only way he can create an environment within which we can have the freedom to choose is to create the exact mess that we have.
Yeah.
An interesting thought. I love this simple little thought. We have to want to find God, to find him. And why did he create a creation where you have to want to find him, to find him? And I believe it's because he doesn't want robots.
Yeah.
And I do believe in a degree, be careful here, a degree of what the Calvinists would call prevenient grace. In other words, I believe he has to give you the grace to find him before you can find him. But it's this weird mystery zone there. I definitely am open to mystery.
but I'm not okay with our blanket things. Like even the whole, you know, will God cause an evil spirit to come on Saul? Guys, please remember, Saul wasn't living a saintly life when that happened. So Saul, he opened all his windows and doors to evil in the first place. And then from their perspective, they said God sent an evil spirit on Saul. Well, I'm okay with that wording. I'm okay with it, fine. But I'm also not acknowledging that Saul took action to put himself in a position to be a recipient of that evil spirit.
I think you're making a good point, though, that when it said God sent an evil spirit, you know, we're talking about a language being translated to English and also them trying to articulate something. So I think that you could be making a good point that, okay, that's not exactly what happened. That was the perception of it. I mean, just like when I'm holding down my son when he's 2 months old to get 3 shots in a row, if he could communicate, he would say, "My dad inflicted pain on me." And I would say, that's just not the full story, son.
But but you wouldn't call his account of that the word of God.
Yeah.
We're getting back into that, you know, kind of literal.
That was another podcast episode.
Yeah,
let's bring this a little more personal, and I give you guys a complete open door not to be sensitive on my behalf, but let's talk about something that y'all are all completely aware of, and that's my struggle with depression. So what would be the case here? Am I not praying enough? Are my friends not praying enough? Am I not claiming God's word enough? Is this on me and my friends and the people that love me? Or would someone say, nah, God could wipe this out if he wants to. It must be his will. Because I would definitely be able to go on a laundry list of good that God has brought out of this. And I guess I personally would go so far as to say, yeah, this, at least right now, this is God's plan for me, whether that's obstacles that he has put in my path to see how I would respond and to see to cause me to be stronger and to teach me perseverance. But I have no problem, and at this point, no other option but to say, yes, this is God's path for me, because I have prayed. I have clung to God's word. I have sought counseling. I have taken medicine. I would say, you know, for the record, I am doing a lot better, but we're talking years and years and years and years of struggle. So how do you guys process that as far as God's plan and our responsibility?
Well, I think personally, I think God has drawn me closer to him through my darkest times.
Yeah.
And you said yourself that you think that ultimately, this depression you struggled with has meant a lot to your faith. So God has brought you from probably your rock bottom to where you are today. You still struggle here and there, but ultimately you can look back and say, okay, I can see good in this. And so I think that's the important point to make. And I know in my own past where I've really had some deep, dark times, I could look back on that and say, look how far I've come through those times. So that's how I would handle that.
Yeah.
So it seems like there's a pretty clear theme in the Bible that God is more than willing to forsake our comforts and our pleasures here on this earth to proclaim his glory. And so...
And that's you know, what you just said, too. I find myself thinking, I just can't let go of... I know that Jesus comes to give life and give it more abundantly. I know that... Because of Jesus, we have purpose here on this earth, and we can give God glory in all things. But I also feel that God's perspective is just so different from ours, because he sees eternity past to eternity future. So when Ryan may see his best friend rotting away in bed with cancer and saying, God, why, God's saying, guys, every single one of you, your life is but mist. You're here one day, gone the next. Now, from your perspective, your friend is dying at a younger age, and it's a pretty horrible ending, but you just can't see the perspective I have. I mean, from an eternal perspective, it just seems like we put a whole lot of stock in the conditions of this life, and I would say maybe unwarranted.
I agree with what you said, 100%.
Yeah, nobody. I don't think anybody's going to disagree with that, because that's the only thing that makes. That's the only thing that can make sense. That's the only way that you can balance an all-good God and an all-powerful God.
Now, Chip, but you, am I correct to say you would push back a little bit on that?
I would push back on it some, probably, but not as much as I would when I was 30. in other words, I believe we do have a warped sense. Like, we probably, if we're all honest, we have, you know, good is God, bad is the devil, you know, comfortable and, you know, appealing to me, it must be God's will. So, I mean, I get that, all of that. Now, I do believe that we have accepted a substandard version of what the kingdom of God could be for us.
Yeah.
I do believe that we have allowed science and technology and the advancements in the natural realm to numb us to the potential of the spiritual realm. So, and I hope that made sense to read between the lines there. I do think we're giving up some things that we could fight for. But not, I don't believe all that enough to disagree with what you're saying, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I think more damage is done by coulda, woulda, shoulda preaching than by just saying, you know what, life's hard and God is good and he's there with us and let's make the best of it with and for each other. But again, just to go on record, I do believe Jesus died for more than us going to heaven. And I believe we're falling short of what we could fight for together.
Yeah. Yeah. Chip, didn't you have, and if I'm mistaken, I think it was you, didn't you actually experience a situation where you felt like you did not pray about a particular situation and it did not go well, and you, under God's grace, you carry a sense of responsibility? Is that?
Yeah. This whole way of thinking, when I was a young Christian, I mean, I've been a Christian now for almost 40 years. This next year will be 40 years, and probably within my first couple of years, I was learning some things that were not, you know, that were a little bit radical. And one of them is this whole stuff about the difference between sovereignty and being in control. And I was driving my car, and I was literally, I can still picture it. It's so real to me. I was on the off-ramp circle of the interstate. Back then it was 26, I guess, by Sam Rittenberg. And the North Charleston sheriff or something had just committed suicide. And as I came off the ramp, I just felt this gentle little whisper in my spirit/soul, that's your fault.
Yeah.
And I was like, pardon me? And I just heard this little impression, that's your fault. And I said, I don't even know this guy. What are we talking about here? And then I felt like God said, if the church prayed like it could and should pray, the pressure people live under in your community would be lessened, decreased, and this man would not have lived with the pressure he lived with, and he would not have killed himself. So you got to follow that chain of circumstances. That I believe there's such a thing as an open heaven. And in other words, I believe all of us would agree we're in a spiritual warfare, which I don't think we take seriously enough. And so some things that happen are not God's will, and they're the result of the church just not taking its place in prayer. And I felt that just marked my soul that there are things that are going to happen in our communities that don't need to happen because the church doesn't pray and doesn't take its proper place of responsibility, authority, and power that go all the way back to the first chapter of the book.
Yeah.
And so it didn't hit me as like this overwhelming personal responsibility that
but it was more God trying to make a point to me, if that makes sense.
Yeah,
that does make sense.
Yeah, and I as well, as we wrap this conversation up, I mean, I would say in my spiritual walk right now, I certainly sense a heightened need for more prayer, and I do believe that it makes a difference. I think that, Chip, what you just explained is specific revelation that God gifted you. Now, I do think that oftentimes when we pray more, we may not know exactly what it's doing, but it's an act of obedience. And we may not ever get that sort of clarity all the time, but it still gives us a responsibility. Because, I mean, some people could take what you just said and run in an unhealthy level and said, see, that Charleston wouldn't have experienced all of that flooding if Christians were just praying. And we just don't know that stuff. I mean, we don't know what is a result of our prayer or lack of. But All right, fellas.
Right.
Well, I think that was some good stuff. Does anybody have anything they want to... they're dying to say before we get off?
I will. If I might just interject one thought in when I was kind of reading a couple things before I got over here, and y'all can edit this out if it turns out that it doesn't have any real relevance.
No, we would
here.
Never do that to you.
But
Ryan,
just immediately go into like a commercial break.
Ryan, it
turns into a product spot.
The last episode you were in, we edited 75%.
Nobody even knew that. <there. laughs> but I was reading an article that C.S. Lewis wrote, and the basic premise of the article is the old question that what's the point of prayer? Like, if we're praying for good things, then God would probably want to do those anyway. And if we're not praying for good things, then God clearly doesn't want to do those things. But one thing that he said that was kind of neat is he likened it to work. And he basically said that if you know you're going to get cavities because you don't brush your teeth, you're clearly going to go brush your teeth. So our actions demonstrate this causality, we're going to say again, that we understand that there's a relationship there between cause and effect in this world. And he basically said that we all agree that about works, but he said if we take that to the next level with prayer, he said this kind of relationships we exercise by work is, so to speak, divinely guaranteed and therefore ruthless. By it, we are free to do ourselves as much harm as we please, but the kind which we exercise by prayer is not like that. God has left himself a discretionary power. Had he not done so, prayer would be an activity too dangerous for man. Prayers are not always, in the crude factual sense of the word, granted. This is not because prayer is a weaker kind of, he actually uses this where I got it, causality. But because it is a stronger kind, when it works at all, it works unlimited by space and time. This is why God has retained a discretionary power of granting or refusing it. Except on that condition, prayer would destroy us. I just wanted to kind of get y'all's take on that, because that does seem to support the idea that if we had access to God's unlimited power, chances are we would use it to either give ourselves ultimate comfort by avoiding all struggle, or we would just use it, basically we would use it for our own ends as opposed to using it for God's ends. And I was just curious to know what y'all's take on that is as far as God's power to withhold the granting, quote-unquote, of prayers.
So, I mean, wouldn't the remedy of that be praying earnestly with a sense of awe and trust in whatever God's will is?
Yeah, but that would kind of bring you back to where he started at the beginning of this, which is if you're praying for good stuff, God's going to want to do that anyway. If you're praying in line with God's will, God's going to do that anyway. And if you're praying bad prayers that are not in line with God's will, he's not going to want to do that anyway, so he's going to use that discretion. My point is, when you guys were saying that God reserves some right, some sovereignty, some power, and he relinquishes that to us, is that where prayer comes in? Is that the missing puzzle piece between God's power and God's intentions playing out on this earth? I mean, do you see it as simple as that?
See, I guess for me, there are only two absolutes when it comes to prayer. One is God will grant you protection from spiritual warfare, so engaging in spiritual warfare, praying for protection. And the second one, I think, is just building a relationship with God. So that constant prayer is connecting to God. So to me, those are the only two 100% absolute guarantees every time you pray. The rest, God can answer, God may choose not to answer. It's all according to God's perspective.
Now,
that's kind of how I look at prayer.
Jared, hearing some of what Chip has said, does that stir at all in you kind of like more of a, yeah, I should be praying more, or not really?
Yeah, I guess because I guess maybe my view of prayer is kind of limited to where I really feel strongly about what I just said. But yeah, I guess there is merit to praying for your leaders, your world. I mean, the Bible does instruct us to do that. And that's probably one area where my prayer life is a little weak, you know. But there's no guarantees. I mean, just because I pray for something that's good, like Lyle was just saying, doesn't necessarily mean that God's going to answer that prayer.
Yeah.
So
Jared, back up for 1 second. So when you were saying the two absolutes about prayer, can you go a little bit further with that? You're saying that those are the two primary purposes of prayer, is to protect us against spiritual warfare and to form kind of I don't mean to make it sound trivial, a buddy-buddy relationship with God.
Jared, you're saying that those are the only two things that we know God will answer favorably, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I meant, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I mean, again, only to provoke thinking, so whatever. But, I mean, it's interesting that we talk about how God can indiscriminately decide to answer a prayer or not answer a prayer. I would love to challenge us all to think about what is a promise. I mean, what is a promise? And then Jesus, I mean, the word says in 1 Corinthians that all of the promises are yes and amen, all of them. So now I am not saying that, you know, I can pray any crazy prayer I want to pray and God's got to answer it, but I'm not prepared to say what you guys are saying, that I have no guarantee God will answer any prayer I pray.
Yeah.
I think the truth, as is typically the case, is not either or, but both and. There's somewhere in the middle where the real power is flowing. And God has promised some things. And if you, in my interpretation of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jesus never turned anyone away that came expecting something. Never. Not one time.
I think that for me, the only thing I can be sure of when it comes to my intentions and my perspective, whether they're right or they're wrong, the only two sure things that I have is my surety of prayer for spiritual protection and prayer for communion with God. The rest, I'm not always sure if it's good intentions or bad intentions. I mean, I can think they are, but ultimately those are the two things I can rest in myself and know that I'm fully committed to God to those two kinds of prayers.
Yeah, so in other
words, I guess that would be my corollary.
Right, so when it says in Matthew 7, God will give you good things when you ask for good things, you're saying there are certain things that we may think is good, and God's like, that's not good for you.
But, Jared, are you saying that if one prays for protection against spiritual warfare, God will grant it 100%? Am I reading too much into that?
That's my faith, man. I believe that. I think if we're being rocked by Satan and spiritual warfare, I mean, you know, spiritual attack, I think God will step in.
So do you think that did Job forget to pray?
You got me there. I mean,
no,
really
see,
not.
We don't have time right now, but Job's easy to deal with.
Oh, I think we
Job's a crappy example of Christianity.
All right, so the title of our one of our next episode is "The Book of Job is Simple." Quote Chip.
It's so simple.
Well, hey, I really actually think that'd be a good thing to talk about. Thanks everybody for joining us. It's a great talk.
Yes.
And we'll catch everybody next time.
Thanks for taking it easy on this stoner, Chip.
All right, well, thank you guys so much for listening to The Pastor with No Answers. I think some of you probably are going to go away with some answers. That's just not our goal. It's not our aim to spoon feed you answers, hence why we have a handful of people on the show that disagree. And bottom line is, typically on this show, we're all Christians, but man, do we disagree.
That should be pretty eye-opening, and it should help us all just kind of get along. And I'm being a little trippy, but at the same time, that is the point of this podcast, is to open all of our eyes on how different we can believe and yet all be in the same family. But before I close out here, I want to just tell you that if you want to join us on Facebook, you can go to facebook.com/BC Pastor. We're also on Twitter, and that handle, that Twitter handle is PWNAPOD. PWNAPOD, like PWNA pod. And then last but not least, let me tell you this. The music in the background, it's from our friend Dan Koch, who is a music-making genius. And if you want to check out more of his stuff, go to dancoke.net. Now, Coke is not spelled like the drink, you dummy. It's actually spelled K-O-C-H. So that's dancoke.net. Go there, check it out. And by the way, if you want to go to iTunes and leave us a review, please do so. It would definitely be very appreciated. And last but not least, for some of you knuckleheads that really like this podcast and you want to just, hey, show it with some monetary giving, there, you are not under no obligation except for if God is telling you to do so right now. And if you can't catch the joke, it is a joke, although you just never know how God's going to work. But you can go to gumroad.com/PWNABC. That's gumroad.com/PWNABC. And honestly, we made that because some of you have asked, how can we give? So we made that for you folks. The rest of you, you just listen for free. Love you all. Have a good one.